myself and some words of wisdom, if I may. What I'm thinking is the general idea of these kinds of sessions is that you guys go to class every day and you learn, maybe you learn computer science, maybe you do some math, maybe you do some sciences, but you don't have a lot of context as to where to put all that, right? So I'm thinking that a big part of these kinds of presentations is just to expose you to different people in different jobs. That's a great thing. So my name is Steve Buxton. I work for MarkLogic, which is, I guess we're not a startup anymore. We were a startup when I joined 12 years ago. There were five software engineers. We had probably 20 people in the company altogether. Now we're up on 101. If you drive north on 101, we've got a sign, which, as you probably know, is a big milestone in the lifetime of any startup. If you've got a sign on 101, that means you made it, right? So we've got a sign on 101 just on the right as you're driving north. The next milestone is $1 billion valuation, and we achieved that 18 months ago. We got a $100 million investment for a 10% share of the company, which, if any of you watch Shark Tank math says that if you pay $100 million for 10% of the company, the company's worth $1 billion. So we're officially a unicorn. We make database software. We're a NoSQL database, so we're not like Oracle and people who only deal in rows and columns. We deal in documents, JSON, XML. We also have semantic capabilities, so we deal in triples and graphs. So we're a multi-model database. We bring in data from all kinds of different sources, model it in some very sophisticated ways, and allow you to do some very rich queries. So I'm a product manager there. I've been there, as I said, for 12 years. I've been a product manager the whole time. The day job of a product manager is to make sure that we build product. And so engineers write the code, architects design the overall system. We have QA engineers who do the testing. We have documentation people who write the documentation. They're all very important. The product manager is the guy who makes sure it all works together. Some companies call them program managers or product owners. We call them product managers. In MarkLogic, the role varies from company to company and sometimes even within a company. But within MarkLogic, product managers are quite technical, so you need to be able to talk technically enough to be able to talk to an engineer and describe what you want him to do for you, what you want him to build, and then understand when he says, no, I can't do that, and tells you 10 reasons why it can't possibly be done. So you have to be reasonably technical. At the same time, you need to be able to converse, you need to be able to talk and write and communicate. We spend a lot of our time talking to engineers, but also a lot of time talking to customers, potential customers, talking to marketing about where the market's heading and what's going to sell, that kind of thing. So say I've been there for 12 years. Before that, I was at Oracle. You probably all heard of Oracle. The big green buildings up there. I did a stint in support, so I did a bit of time in support. Then I ran a small engineering team building support tools that track support tickets as they come in at the help desk. We built a knowledge base so you could answer questions automatically somewhat. So I was at Oracle for 14 years. I ended up there as a product manager working on Oracle Text, pulling full text search into a relational database. Before that, as you can tell by my hair, I go quite a long way back. I got a degree in computer science in the UK back in 1981. Back in 1981, computer science degrees weren't that common, so I didn't have a lot of choices of places to go to college, but I went to Warwick University and got one of the early computer science degrees. I worked in various roles. I started off as an engineer, building code in assembler. Anybody know what assembler language is? Assembler?
What's assembler?
I'm not sure, but isn't it just like zeros and ones?
It's almost, it's very nearly zeros and ones, yeah. So you've got high-level programming languages like Java, going down the stack, kind of C++ and C are low-level languages. Assembler is the lowest level you can get. You have a very limited set of operations, and they map directly to zeros and ones, so you're almost at the zeros and ones level. You've got 16 registers. There's no multiplication, no division. You can move things into a register. You can add registers together. You've got a program counter. You've got a stack pointer. How many people study computer science or do some programming or? Okay, so just a story I tell to illustrate how low level assembler is two things. One is there's no multiplication and no division. You have to write your own functions for that by successive addition, successive subtraction. The other is there's no notion of functions. If you want to write a function, call a function, you push your parameter values onto the stack because you've got a stack. You go to the program counter that starts the function. The function starts by pulling its parameters off the stack. At the end of the function, you go to the program counter, which is the last thing you pop off the stack. So it's really kind of primitive. So that's where I started out. I did that for a couple of years. The reason I moved on was I got to the point where the first time I wrote a program from scratch, and it compiled and linked and ran the first time, and I wasn't surprised. That was the point where I thought, well, I could do this. And I kind of looked at where I was compared with my peers, and I was pretty good. I was never going to be the best programmer in the world. I was good enough to make a living out of it, but I was never going to be, you know, a great programmer. And what I discovered was there are all kinds of roles where you can be a pretty good programmer, a pretty good technical person, and pretty good at something else as well, and kind of make a living out of doing the two together. And that's my first words of wisdom that I want to pass on to you is you don't necessarily have to be the world's best programmer to make it in the world of computers. There are all kinds of roles. There's, as I say, QA and documentation, and there's marketing and there's management and so on. And there's also this notion that if you're not the absolute best in the world at one thing, think about two things. Think about two things that interest you, and you can be the best in the world at that, at the conjunction, if you like, at the crossover point of those two things. So a PM is typically thought of as very good technically, very good on the communication side, and it's that crossover point. That's my first word of wisdom. Any questions?
Oh, what was it like going from Oracle to MarkLogic? Like, was it a lot different? Or?
It was hugely different. Because when I joined Oracle in 91. Gosh, you guys weren't born in 91. In 91, all the data. In 91, there were a lot of different database companies, a lot of relational database companies, and they were all kind of more or less the same. So there was Sybase and Oracle, and Postgres and Ingres and a whole bunch of them. Oracle at that time hadn't stood out as much as it does now. And they'd all had a really bad year for lots of different reasons. Oracle, well, partly because of their own doing, there was some questionable sales commission practices where sales guys would, so I would go to you and I say, I'm going to sell you 100 units of software for $100,000. And you say, oh, great. And I say, well, why don't you sign a piece of paper that says that you intend to buy another 100,000 next year? And we won't hold you to it. So if you don't want to sell, it, you know, it doesn't cost you, there's no commitment there, but just sign that piece of paper and then I'll get the commission on it. And that was all kind of questionable with a capital Q.
Yeah.
So all the database companies were going through a bit of a slump. They were all going through a hard time. Larry Ellison, who a lot of people say is an a-hole, and I think that's absolutely true. He's also a genius. He took his executives off-site, spent a week off-site, and said, we have to turn this around. And he turned Oracle around in a quarter, whereas the other database companies, it took them several quarters, a year, 2 years. And in my mind, that's where Oracle won the database wars, in the summer of 91, when Larry took that attention. Sorry, I'm waffling now. What was the question? What was it like?
Question,
oh, right. So even though Oracle was one of a handful, it wasn't, you know, the premium database vendor it is now, we still had thousands of people on that site with the green buildings. They were still building the green buildings as well, was there? A lot of bureaucracy, a lot of hierarchy. I worked for a team that worked for that rolled up to a manager, that rolled up to another manager, Ray Rucker 40, but was still two levels down from Larry, but he ran 500 developers. And so if I wanted to go above my manager, the next guy above that ran 500 developers. So lots and lots of people, lots of, say, bureaucracy, politics, hard to get things done, very long cycles, so 2 year development cycles, where at least 6 months at the end is stabilization. So you're not actually doing anything useful. You're just making sure your code fits with everybody else's for the last 6 months. And then it's the last year, and then it's the last 18 months, and it's like, wow. You're doing less and less actual useful work in the cycle. So there are a lot of good things about working for a big company. You know, your mother knows who they are. The benefits tend to be really good. There's lots of opportunities within the company. You know, without moving somewhere else, you can move to different teams. But it can be very frustrating. Now, from that to MarkLogic, 20 people in the company, we've got 5 developers. I was hired on as the very first product manager and told, figure out what product management should look like at MarkLogic. It's a different kind of opportunity. So one of the things I really liked about the startup was we got to make stuff up. You know, over in Oracle land, there's all kinds of rules and processes, and you have to do this, you have to do that. You know, over in MarkLogic land, well, how long should a cycle be? And how many QA people do we need per engineer? And you know, what should our messaging be? What should we tell people? What should be the public face of MarkLogic? We got to just make that stuff up. Not me personally, but me and a very small group of people. So that was great. Yeah.
So as a product manager, you're mentioning you have to talk with marketing and like the engineers and stuff like that. So how do you, I guess, kind of manage that intersection of like their requirements, like each individual requirement from these different teams, if that makes sense?
Yeah, well, that's the hardest thing. I mean, that's the hardest thing. The most challenging thing is to figure out what are we going to build in the next release and the release afterwards. So making sure we're building the right thing at the right time in the right way. And we used to have a DMV acronym, see if I can remember it. D is deals in progress, marketing, and vision. So there are a lot of different ways to look at it, but that's one way, is to say, well, if you've got deals in progress and you're a small company, and when I first joined MarkLogic, when we signed a deal, when we signed one deal to one customer, it was a huge deal. We had a big bell that used to ring, and everybody used to clap and cheer. Oh, we sold a piece of software. So deals in flight are tremendously important. And if you can build something that will make that deal happen, whereas it wouldn't have happened, or make that customer happy, whereas he wouldn't have been happy, that carries a lot of weight versus something we think might make future customers happy, but we don't really know. There's a certainty. So deals in flight, market, what do we see in the market? What's that competition doing? What are other people doing? Where do we think the market's going? What's new that's coming on board? Is it cheap memory? Is it fast disk? Is it, you know, nowadays it's AI and ML. Everybody's talking about artificial intelligence and machine learning. So where's the market going? What are the new things that are going to spur the next big step forward? And then what would be vision? Especially as a startup, you have to have a core vision. You know, you have to have an idea of who you are and where you're going. And at MarkLogic, we started off saying, our vision has changed over time, but we started off saying, it's the best place to store documents. So if you've got documents, whether they be legal contracts or news or whatever, store them in MarkLogic. Very, very fast, very scalable, and you can do very rich queries over them. So Lexis. Anybody heard of the Lexis database? It's one of the biggest databases in the world. And if you're a lawyer, you generally subscribe to the Lexis database and the Westlaw database. Those are the two big legal databases. And you do a lot of your legal research on the Lexis database. And that runs on MarkLogic. They make over $1 billion a year in subscriptions on their legal database running on MarkLogic. And they hold, you know, court cases and precedent and rulings and all that kind of stuff.
Any other
questions?
Oh, what was like university like in the UK?
Oh, it was very different from here. There's no frats in the UK, but everybody can drink beer.
I see.
So in the UK, you can, maybe this is not appropriate, but in the UK, you can drink beer as soon as you're 18.
Yeah.
And so there's bars and clubs on campus, so
yeah.
Everybody can go out and have a beer, which is a good thing.
Mm-hmm.
Shorter cycle, it's only 3 years to get a degree instead of four. Much more focused. So the idea of doing a year or two at college and you haven't figured out what your major is yet, that's just like, that's ridiculous, right? What are you doing?
Mm-hmm.
In the UK, you apply for a particular degree. You always declare your major up front. Very hard to change once you get there. And most of your classes are in that major. So I did computer science. First year, we did a lot of math, a couple of electives, but mostly computer science, and same for the 3 years. I'm looking for time, 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
So if there's no pressing questions, I'll offer you my second words of wisdom. My first was look for two things. Look for a combination of things, look a combination of skills. That'll make you stand out, and that'll make you attractive to an employer, even if you can't be the absolute Olympic champion in one thing. My second word of wisdom is a story. And you might have heard the story of the stonemason. It was Aesop, sorry, Aesop's fables. So the story goes, there's a stonemason, and he's sitting at the bottom of the mountain and he's chipping away at the mountain. That's his job. He chips away at the mountain, makes stones, they get carted off and built into buildings. So he's chipping away and he's grumbling and he thinks he's got a really crappy life. And he looks up at the sun, and the sun's beating down on him. And he says, well, why do I have to be a stonemason? Why can't I be the sun?
Yeah.
The sun is obviously ruler of the universe. The sun is the best thing to possibly be. So there's a change in the wind, and as you all know, in fables at least, when there's a change in the wind, magical things happen. And he became the sun. He's sitting up in the sky and he's the sun and he's shining down and he's really happy for a little while. As he's beating down on the poor stonemason at the bottom of the mountain, along comes a cloud. And the cloud obscures the sun. And he says, well, this is no good. I thought I was going to be the sun. I thought I was going to be the best, most powerful, most important. There's this cloud. I want to be a cloud. When it changes again, he becomes a cloud. He's very happy being a cloud for a little while. Eventually, he comes up against the mountain. And the cloud can go anywhere it likes, but it can't go past the mountain. It's disgruntled again. I thought I was the most powerful when I was the cloud, but obviously the mountain is more powerful than I am. I want to be a mountain. He becomes the mountain. And in case you hadn't guessed it yet, the story goes full circle. He's the mountain, and he feels this chipping at the bottom. There's a stonemason bashing away and cutting him up. And he's like, well, maybe it was the stonemason all along that was the most powerful. And the moral of the story is all of those things are important. You know, in a company such as a startup or in a big company like Oracle, all of those roles are important. And I think when you start off, my son graduated from Bellarmine Arts in 2016, and I know from talking to him, you know, you're thinking about, I want to be the next Mark Zuckerberg, or I want to be the CEO of this, or I want to invent a new software program that wins the Nobel Prize. But the moral of the fable is, all of those roles are important. There's lots and lots of different roles out there, and they're all important. You know, we couldn't build software without engineers, without product managers, without testers, without doc writers, without marketing people to sell, without even sales guys. Even salespeople are important. So that's my second words of wisdom.
Okay. Yeah. Working in like Silicon Valley, what are some like the biggest changes you've seen as far as like computer programming or database management?
Well, it goes in cycles. It changes almost completely every few years.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly when I joined Oracle, databases were on the rise. Mm-hmm. And it's like, ooh, databases, they seem to be really, really important. Nowadays, the database is pushed way down. It's more invisible. A lot of people are selling software as a service. There's a database there. You just don't see it. So that's... You know, one thing about databases in particular. Programming in general. I'm biting my tongue a little bit because I don't want to sound like the grumpy old guy that says kids have to get off my lawn. But programming is being dumbed down. You know, from when I started, where you had those 16 registers and you had full control over everything that went on in the machine, and now with JavaScript, a lot of people like JavaScript, but it's dumbing everything down. You know, it's doing everything for you, and you're cutting and pasting. To illustrate that, HTML5, you know, the HTML standards. In HTML5. You don't have to close off brackets. And when you quote a string, you do the start string quotes, and you don't have to do the end string quotes. The compiler or the interpreter is supposed to figure that all out for you. Well, that just drives me nuts. That's like saying you can write a novel, but you don't have to spell the words right, and the punctuation is not really important. The reader can just figure it out on their own, and that drives me crazy. Software development is a science, and it shouldn't be that sort of slapdash, like, oh, everything's supposed to be easy. It's not easy and simple. Sometimes it's like digging a trench. You know, sometimes you have a deal of work to do, and you just have to work through it. And making everything easy like that is a bad thing.
How long did it take you to get to understand programming, like a language, like your first language?
How long? Not terribly long. Certainly after the first, the second, the third, the fourth language, not very long at all, because every language has functions and loops and libraries and compilers. So languages are, at some level, basically the same. The first language, Maybe a year. My first year of college, we did Fortran, which people don't use anymore. Maybe a year of class. Do you write programming languages? Or?
No. Well, I took a class last year.
Yeah. Did you like it?
Yeah, it was fun.
It is kind of magical. You know, it's kind of magical when you write stuff down and it actually makes things happen. It can be very satisfying, especially when you do it. When you do it on a big scale and you end up writing layers on layers on layers and building these very large, sophisticated structures, when they actually work, I love it when things work. When things actually work, it can be really, really satisfying.
I think that's all the time we have. And thank you.
Thank you. Freebies on the way out.
Also, would you guys be able to take a picture?